And here we've got the least worries, and they're mainly things about hygiene and what people do and diet and so on, what we subsequently called lifestyle characteristics, things actually which people believe they have control over. And then going into the bottom nine are the things that people worry most about, and there you'll see additives, animal welfare, antibiotics, pesticides, hormones, things that people perceive of as scientists doing to their food. We use a technique called factor analysis in order to cement this idea that there were two major strands to public concerns with respect to food safety. And we called one of the factors that was identified technological or uncontrollable, and this just shows the individual features which are most strongly associated with that particular, as it were, concentrated concern. And lifestyle factors, again, the things that were most closely associated with that. We then use another technique called cluster analysis, which allows you to categorize people according to the way they react to these two kinds of food safety concerns. And this is the outcome. So we've got the horizontal axis describing the lifestyle concerns, and the vertical axis, the technological or uncontrollable factors. And it's more worried to less worried. Now, as you might expect, there was a major cluster of people who were associated with what I've just said about the ranking of these factors, which were worried about technological factors but not really worried about lifestyle factors. I suppose that's the typical consumer. But there's another cluster that was a bit neutral about both of these things and ended up in the middle there. Then there was a third cluster that didn't worry about anything. Young, male, well-educated, and probably mainly students. And there was a cluster that worried about everything, and they were mainly female. This is not our own survey, it's another survey, but it summarizes this hierarchy of consumer concerns about food safety, with least concern being expressed with respect to diet, and most concern being expressed in relation to pesticides and what people call chemicals in their food. Now, most medical and food science specialists would say that people have got this the wrong way around, that they should be worrying more about the things at the top and less or not at all about the things at the bottom. And just to underpin that, this is a slide that was shown by the then newly appointed chairman of the Food Standards Agency in another Cameron Gifford lecture called Is Food Safe?, in which he highlighted his view about the deaths associated with food, with diet and health coming at the top, and then in the middle, food poisoning, food allergies, and the human variant of BSE. And at the bottom, nothing for the others. Now this produces a dilemma for food policy. It's led to the application of something called the theory of perceived risk to trying to understand what it is that leads people to worry more about the things that they shouldn't worry about and worry less about the things that scientists think they should worry about. Summarized in this table by listing factors which seem to exaggerate concern about the dangers of particular food risks, and factors which lead them to be less concerned, to reduce their attitudes to them. And you'll see that these technological factors, the things that I've shown you that people express concern about, are consistent with these novel, uncontrollable, man-made, involuntary aspect compared to the lifestyle factors which are controllable. In amongst all of this is also something which has become known as the Daily Mail effect, which is partly responsible for converting these amplification factors into food scares. The dilemma for food policy is, should resources be put into addressing things that people are worried about, or should resources be put into things that scientists think they ought to be worried about? Connected with this is a question about whether these worries reflect a genuine belief that there are greater dangers associated with the technological food hazards, or whether it's just that people find some kinds of risk more acceptable than others. And underpinning it all, of course, is the fact that for this very reason, you will normally find expenditure on methods attempting to deal with, for example, diet and health as a food safety issue, concentrating on the benefits to society as a whole rather than necessarily to the perceived benefits of the individual themselves. And this takes me then on to the final section, which is some remarks about food consumers and food ethics. Now, thinking about this, I came to the conclusion that there was two main ways in which food ethics interact with the food consumer. And the first of these is the ethical consumer, a term that's really appeared just over the last 10 to 15 years, but where you have ethical motives in food purchase decisions. Describing ethics, best perhaps by the mission of the Food Ethics Council, to promote a food system which is healthy, sustainable, and fair, underpinned by three principles derived from moral philosophy, reflecting the well-being of individuals, autonomy, freedom and choice, and justice, fairness. Now, food consumers can vote for a more ethical food system by what they buy. And also, of course, by what they don't buy, by boycotting certain products that they believe to be unethical. And this leads us on to the necessity of distinguishing in motives for food purchase between those which are associated with the health and well-being of the individual, him or herself, known as use values, and those which are concerned with the perception of the individual of the impact on the way that product has reached the consumer on society as a whole. Even this distinction is a bit blurred, like most distinction at the edges, because if I consume a carrot, I might actually enjoy it more simply because I know that it's been, you know, brought up well. But nevertheless, this is an important distinction. The difficulty is knowing just what is the balance between the use values and the non-use values. and the degree to which people are actually genuinely buying what they believe to be ethical products for ethical reasons rather than for reasons connected with their own satisfaction in terms of food consumption. Organic products are quite a good example of this because we know from the work that we've done and with other people have done that organic consumers buy organic products because, or at least they say, because they taste better, more nutritious, and safer. But also because they're better for the environment, animal welfare friendly, and support small local farmers, irrespective of the fact that, of course, much organic produce travels a long distance before it reaches the organic consumer. One way of trying to get closer to the degree to which ethical motives influence food purchase decisions is to compare the actual behavior of people in terms of whether they buy ethical products, I'm using organic products as an example here, or they don't, and then compare the attitudes of the two groups. Now, in the European survey that we undertook, we included a question which was, how important were the following in your decision to buy food products? Now, this is just the UK data. And here, of course, if you ask questions like that, then most people say that all of these things are important because they're good things and you should say that they're important. You feel they ought to be important. So probably more should be read into the ranking from the most important to less important. That's what I've done here for the full sample of 1,000 consumers in the UK. See, top of the list is animal welfare friendly, and there are things to do with fairness and tracing to the original supplier. And somewhat surprising, right at the bottom, the high profile current issues of energy use, carbon, transport, and climate change. But we were able to divide the sample into people who regularly bought organic products and people who did not, a larger number who did not. And what we then found was that the people who regularly bought organic products regarded all of these things as more important than the people who didn't buy organic products. But the degree to which there was a gap between the importance attached by the organic consumers to non-organic consumers varied. And so in this second table, I've ranked the same ethical issues according to the extent to which the person who buys an organic product regards it as more important compared to the non-organic consumer. And now you'll see, well, support for small producers appearing again is important to organic consumers, no impact on the environment, but the energy carbon issues, big gap between the views of organic consumers and non-organic consumers on the importance of